Thank you. Welcome and happy Sunday to you. We are in week three of the Forza Racing Championship, part of the Porsche Cup. And finally, Scott Cole, along with Allie here. And we're going to have a good amount of racing today. And for the first time, we can talk about the Le Mans Finals. Come on, we've known about it for a while, but now it's out to the public.
Yeah, it's so cool, right? It's so cool. Finally, all my Steve McQueen knitwear that I've been saving up for all those years.
Here we go.
It's going to pay off, you know. Yeah, it's going to be an amazing event, though. Right? I mean, what an incredible race. I've never been before myself. I'm sure that's the case for a lot of the community
sure.
as well. And so what a great place to finish this season.
100 drivers in one place, and they, I believe, will be on the podium with the winner of the actual Le Mans.
I know.
Real race? I don't even know how to talk about it.
I mean, an incredible honor. And, you know, we've seen over the years esports racing coming on and on, strength by strength. And it's great to see, you know, that respect starting to build for the talent that these guys are showing and for the skills that are involved in putting together wins like this.
Well, we're still a couple of weeks away from that, to getting to France. We still got one more week of racing. But today's race, let me tell you a little bit about the tournament format here. And there's two ways to get in, Allie.
Yeah, exactly. So we've got 50 drivers qualifying from two different paths to Le Mans. On the one side, we've got the Rivals path. That's the top 50 drivers on a set of leaderboard challenges, and that's going to be a global top 50. On the other hand, we've got a race path. There's 50 in total, once again, but these are coming through regions instead of globally. So you can see there, 23 top drivers from Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, and a bunch more regions as well that you're all very able to read yourselves.
Well, on the Rivals path, that's one way you can get in here. And well, we've had a couple weeks of that, still another week to go.
Yeah, just one more event left there. I mean, we've seen some of the best drivers on Forza choosing the Rivals path. I think those people who are able to put in those alien lap times really above everybody else have thought, you know, it's the path of least resistance. Go ahead, take that, and not go with the races. The races, on the other hand, we've still got another week remaining after this one. So that's another 2 weeks of competition for that.
So if you was you, what path would Allie be taking to the championship?
I think judging by the level of competition on the Rivals path, I would be forced to take the racing path. But I'm not so good on track. So we'd have to wait and see. We'd have to get a bit lucky, I think.
Well, we've had some great races in the first couple weeks here in week three. There's still one more week to go. There's starting to be some urgency for some of these drivers.
There definitely is. You know, the people who didn't make it through in week one, who didn't score the big points there, are definitely now looking to make up for that. You know, with only 12 spaces open in the final three races, that's where all the biggest points are. You've got to make your claim, and you've got to make it early in this championship.
Well, we got here a little bit earlier today, watching a little bit of the semifinals. What were some of your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, great racing already. I think we're in for a real treat this week. And some new faces as well. Good to see a few of them are popping up. JSR Lee Campbell, it was good to see him out racing at the same time as YMTV Mellish as well. Another good name in there.
Yeah, he was here last week.
Yeah, right.
Now he's back in the cockpit doing his thing.
Yeah, exactly, showing everyone what a deadly driver he is.
Top class out of him. Well, we are just about ready for that first race. Let's take a look at how the starting position for this grand final race number two. And there's the man that looked really good in the semis, Attack Johnson.
Yeah, I mean, brilliant to see him back once again. An absolutely commanding victory from him last week at VIR. So he'll be hoping to repeat that once again. Anto there in second and Eggy in third. I mean, those are strong results there for two guys who are maybe a little bit more mid-pack sometimes previously.
One of the surprises for me is all the way down at position number 11, Kaiser Wolf did not finish strong in the semis.
Exactly. I mean, we saw him in the New York Invitational and in previous seasons as well. Definitely a very, very fast driver. And, you know, with this same grid appearing in all three races coming up, he's going to have his work cut out from 11th position. It's also worth noting, one person who isn't in the final this week is championship leader from EMEA, TX3 Paps. So not managing to make it through the semi-final stage this time. I mean, he's going to have to really bring it out in the last event.
Yeah, we'll see how that affects the standings. Well, we got ready for our first race. It's on Hockenheim, and we'll be racing in the 911 GT3 RS4.0.
What a beautiful car. I mean, it's so fun to drive. A real track car. You know, you guys can go and have a little go on it around a few of the tracks. pretty nice out of the box. At the same time, it's very stiff. It has a very stiff chassis. And so if you hit a bump, clip a curb a little bit too hard, you can find yourself up on three or even two wheels.
Well, we got some tight corners that these guys are going to be bringing themselves through. Look for a lot of action. It starts with the Nord Curve.
It does. First turn here. Lots of runoff on the way out of it. We might see some guys just choosing not to go, choosing to take the runoff, just instead of threatening the inside of this corner, especially on lap one.
Well, going into turn four and five, you got to take it delicate. It's a white gloves kind of turn.
It is. Double apex right-hander there. Very, very slow, but a very good overtaking opportunity as well. I mean, further on the track, though, we've got the hardest curve, I think, in this track. It's mobile with that massive gravel trap on the outside.
Yeah, we were running some practice laps earlier. You got to watch for that gravel runoff. You can end up in the tires real quick.
You definitely, definitely can. I mean, yeah, it's just going to be about keeping your nose clean through there, making sure that you save it for overtaking possibilities like Sud Curve here, the last one on the track. Excuse my German pronunciation there. I'm not sure how to say that.
That's close enough for me. I'm American. You know, you're from here in Britain, so we'll let that one pass today. But, you know, there's going to be some interesting curves, and you're going to need some spacing. It's going to be the question of, are we going to have some patience here, or are you going to have some perseverance? And we start off the top with, like we said, Johnson and Anto. And there is Edgy. Diesel looking to make a good run here. Any dark horses? We know about Mr. Jack. We know about Anto. We know about Johnson. Any dark horses here?
Yeah, I mean, FCT Vita, you saw him last week. Very, very strong. It's great to see Lee Campbell out here taking a break from tuning cars. And
there's your guy, Mellish.
There he is. Eighth position there for Mellish. He's going to have some work to do if he wants to win any of these races. U-Type just behind him, and Shelby towards the back here. Kaiser Wolf, though, I mean, 11th, he's not going to be happy with that.
Yeah, that's way in the back, and Warrior is going to be the man in 12th, bringing up the rear. And we are just about set and ready to go here for race number one, and we are all greens. And I'll tell you what, this first turn might see some sparks.
It's
already Edgy going off the side.
It's a tough old turn. You know, we saw Anto there just taking it nice and safe through there. Always very, very good to see. So, you know, he's getting away with it just about. I mean, we've certainly got the pack not really spacing out yet, which is always good to see. Lots of overtaking opportunities in this first lap.
Yeah, you know, I think now that we're in week three, there's so many opportunities that you can't afford to drop back to where Kaiserwolf is. Well back there, you see Mellish already moving into six, and Diesel gets off the side. And that's what we talked about. We talked about that gravel road. Anytime you take it a bit too hard on that turn, next thing you know, you're off on the side.
Yeah, exactly. We can hop up here, though, to 11th place, just one forward from Diesel, because Pro Warrior is just biding his time here. And on the inside, that was Shelby coming together with Kaiser Wolf. So those two losing out there.
Yeah, so the first of 11 laps here in the grand final race number one. We're here in week three. Mellish already up to fifth, Edgy in sixth. There's a little bit of jostling coming around the outside. And there's Diesel all the way back, bringing up the pack. And Shelby has really dropped back from his starting position grid.
Yeah, he definitely has. You know, you need to be performing better than that. These races, you know, a little bit longer this week, 11 laps, but still quite short. You need to string together an almost perfect race in order to make yourself move forward a lot of positions. Here we are just on board now with Kaiser Wolf running in 10th position. He's looking at the back of Lee Campbell here, who's doing a good job to defend so far, and you can see him changing his line there, trying to defend that car.
Yeah, there's Vita up in third right now. He's trailing Anto and Johnson. And I tell you, if Johnson's racing the way that he did in the semis, he's going to be a really tough racer to contend with today.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, Johnson, you know, is someone who seems to have found such incredible form for season three. So it's really good to see him out here still leading this race. But Bam Anto, I mean, as you say, you know, he's not giving up.
Now, Vita looked pretty good in the semis as well. He's carrying some of that momentum through. It's just, when you have Anto and Johnson ahead of you, that's two tough drivers to overtake.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this pack, though, it hasn't separated as much as you might think it has. If we hop back here now to Kaiser Wolf, you can see Lee Campbell has found his way back through. So these two guys swapping positions here in the battle for sixth. I mean, Look at that track map, though, in the bottom left of the screen. You can see everybody is more or less still bunched up. Look at that. Campbell's wide there on his way through the stadium complex. Kaiserwolf looking pretty punchy there in seventh position.
Well, here comes that big turn. 12 and 13. This is a chance to make a move. And Kaiserwolf's done a nice job. Started in 11th, has already moved himself up to 7. I think if he can get somewhere up in the top 5, that would prove to be a good race for Kaiserwolf.
Yeah, it definitely would. I mean, but sitting there in 7th right now, and he doesn't look like he's moving forward. You can see a little bump there from Mr. Jack just behind. And we can glance backwards now and see Mr. Jack threatening on Kaiserwolf, just running that slightly defensive line there towards the braking zone. And Mr. Jack fishing around on the inside, looking for a way through. I mean, it's great driving. It's great to watch how close people can drive their cars to one another without necessarily getting that contact, without having to muscle their way past.
Well, Mr. Jack is trying not to be denied here, and he will get to that inside position. So he will move up, a couple touches in there, but oh boy, gonna get on the inside.
Yeah, Diesel just behind there. He thought he could make a little bit of a train with Mr. Jack, and both of them passed Kaiserwolf, but denied. Absolutely, and that you can see that squabble just playing out behind 8th position here, really looking like the cork in the bottle.
8 to 12, there is not a lot of spacing between these guys, and sometimes you see, you know, someone get off on the side and they'll fall back away from the pack, but both these guys, you know, from 8 really on back are saying really tough right now.
Yeah, for sure. Look at that, just on the outside of Warrior there, Shelby trying to get himself out of 12th and last position. All these drivers are so fast. You have to remember that, you know, given a golden ticket, any single one of them could take the win.
Well, this is your guy Mellish. He's already moved up. He's in 4th place, trading behind Vita. It's really been Johnson and Anto 1 and 2 out in front, but Mellish starting to slowly catch up with Vita.
Exactly, and if you look on that track map once again, you can see the pair of Johnson and Anto have pulled away a little bit, and then Vida and Mellish are making the second pack here, and all the action is happening in that battle for 5th just behind. So, I mean, Mellish, Vida, Johnson, and Anto all doing a great job. Everyone else is fighting for scraps.
What's your thoughts here as a driver? You'll want to move into 3rd place, but you know you got a slew of guys behind you that if you make one little mistake trying to overtake, next thing you know, you could fall back to 8th, 9th, or worse.
Exactly. I mean, when you watch them coming through corners like this very difficult double left-hander, then onto the right, you know that you shouldn't be making an overtaking move through here. That's a slow way of overtaking. You know, you want to find somewhere which will minimize the amount of time lost. A little slide there. For Mellish on his way through towards the stadium complex. So you need to find a way of overtaking that can allow both the partners in that overtake to not lose a lot of time. Otherwise, before you know it, you're back in the jaws of F4H Eggy.
I know he's your guy, but Vita looks really comfortable in 3rd place. Mellish is probably racing a bit out of his skill gap right now, just trying to catch up with Vita.
Exactly. He's pushing like crazy. New to competition racing, Mellish. So maybe showing a few nerves there as he chases down 3rd position. But that's a strong place to be chasing. We're back here with Kaiserwolf once again, who's now in 8th position. I think that's actually where we left him last time, with Mr. Jack just in front. So these very, very fast racers all looking just to get their heads down and push up to the pack up ahead.
Yeah, so he's riding in 8th place right now. He's got Mr. Jack. That's the guy he's trying to overtake right now, who's played really well and driven really well in the series so far, up on the leaderboards. But they are well behind the leader, Johnson, who's really looked strong from wire to wire thus far here in lap number 5.
You know, it's so great to see Johnson just managing to hold that lead. You know, he's been a player who's had a lot of bad luck through the years. To an extent, I think drivers do make their own luck, but certainly Johnson hasn't been able to string the wins together. So it's great to see him here just really succeeding in season 3. Kaiserwolf, though, any moment now, I think that lunge is going to come in.
Yeah, not a lot of changes thus far. You see Shelby all the way back in 10th, Warrior in 11th. But it's been the leader, Johnson, who's been holding off Anto. Really, from the start, Anto has been unable to make any moves. See if we can move up front there and and check on what's going on with our leaders. And you see it's really been two or three car lengths really the entire time. And every time they come out of a turn or hit a stretch, it's Johnson that's been pulling away. Gets a little bit squirrely there. Lost a little time. This could be the chance for Anto to move up here, Allie.
Yeah, Johnson just taking the defensive line there, but Anto is so confident on the brakes. Look at that, hanging it around the outside there. He's managed to stay relevant.
To the right flat.
Yeah, exactly. He just pushed through, and that's what Johnson's done.
Yeah, he had the proper line there. Anto trying to go around on the outside, but you mentioned time and time again, when you go through that curve, if you can stay to the right and stay flat, that's when you can keep that speed up.
Brilliant driving from Johnson. Just kept his cool, kept his line, and managed to retake that lead. So important with 6 laps out of 11 now gone by.
You can see how important the torque is in the second and third gears. That's really the gears that you're going to see mostly used when you're going through these turns. And when you start to push it up, that's when you can find yourself on the side.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you need those high revs just to make sure that you can get the rotation in the rear end of this car just mid-corner, because it has got a tendency to be a little bit understeery, a little bit numb on corner entry.
Here, lap number 6, making our way through the hairpin, coming down into the sud curve. You're going to see them power down about 60 to 70 miles an hour before accelerating onto that stretch.
Such a difficult right, double right-hander, that one. I mean, yeah, it just makes your thumbs ache. You know, after 7 laps, after 11 laps of gripping onto a controller, you know, it's almost unwelcome when you have to hold the steering angle in for that long, that with that much accuracy.
Well, Johnson taking that first turn a lot better than he did in lap number 6. And let's see if Anto can find his way to the inside here. I think that's his best chance is through that curve. If he can stay to the right and pick up speed, the only problem is every turn that Johnson comes out of, he's the one accelerating. He's the one picking up time, and Anto's just left a few lengths behind.
Yeah, exactly. I just want to jump back here to FCT Vida, though, in 11th position. I think he's just had a spin there on first straight.
He was third for the majority of this race, but he has fallen back.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's not ideal at all. You try and string your race together. You try and keep the laps consistent. Just keep putting it in. But this level of competition, a tiny mistake, it's all it takes. And I think probably just bouncing on the outside of turn one, bouncing across those curbs, has led him into grief.
Well, you could talk about, you know, when you go through 6 or 7 laps, you have a comfortability, and sometimes you're just not holding those lines, not coming out of those apexes as crisp as you'd like. So Vita's fallen back to 11. Mr. Jack is now in 6. Kaiserwolf has moved to 7th. It's been all about Johnson and Anto up at the front. But Mellish, your guy, has now found his way into 3rd place after the fall back by Vita.
Of course, yeah. Bumping himself up now onto the podium has Mellish. So that's really good to see. I mean, if you have a look here, maybe we can... Yeah, if you look on the map on the bottom left there, Mellish is at the very head of this pack that you can see just disappearing through turn 2 there. And Johnson and Anto are way, way ahead. So Mellish will need to really, he has his work cut out. You know, he'll have to really get his head down in order to catch up with the leader in second place.
Yeah, he's got Edgy on the back of him. That's really the closest battle there between getting yourself on the podium as Johnson and Anto continue to battle. 3rd and 4th is a possibility, but the gap between 2nd and 3rd is quite huge right now.
If we jump up though to 2nd place, bam, Anto has taken the lead of this race, and he's just sitting in front of Johnson now. The move took place, I think, on turn 5. That was the left-hander into the double left. Anto is up the inside. Johnson now, it's still a very fresh wound for him. He's not comfortable at all in 2nd place, and he wants to be right back there.
Yeah, leading for all 7 of our 8 laps, but it was Anto, really much just timing his opportunity. He had several attempts at trying to overtake Johnson through those first 7 laps, but here in the 8th, found a little opening, and now he's going to have to play defensive for these last 3 laps.
It's only fair in a way. You know, Anto is sat there behind Johnson, and now he gets the chance to say, all right, I'm going to set the pace now. I'm going to start pushing. Let's see how fast we can make these Porsches, you know, get it around Hockenheim National.
Yeah, met both these guys at the New York Invitational to start off season three. Both great guys, good competitors. As you see, Johnson, who's had a lot of success with that turn, but Anto able to close the door.
It is. I mean, it's incredible to see sometimes with these lines these top competitors put down, they look wrong almost. I mean, Anto was wider there on the exit to turn two, and he sometimes looks like he should be slower, but the feet increase, you know, the feet increase, and that's that kind of alien skill that you see at this level of Forza Motorsport 6.
So Johnson, just a half a second behind Anto here. Is that's really where the only battle's going on the track. We've had Kaiserwolf able to move up to sixth, Shelby's moved up to ninth, Vita still struggling. For six laps, he was in third position, but has fallen all the way back to 11.
Disastrous there for Vita. I mean, you practice and practice all week for these events. These drivers will all be very, very familiar with this track car combination. And it's just very unfortunate when the worst happens at the competition itself.
So Johnson in second, Anto with the lead.
Yeah, there they go, down the pit straight. Two more circulations of this track remain. Not long for Anto to have to hold on now. And Johnson, I mean, look at that, 120 feet, 130 feet. He looks like he's falling back here.
Yeah, he had a lot of good turns where he was coming in out of the apex and was able to accelerate, was actually pulling away from Anto in those first seven laps. But now that Anto has the lead and he's holding more of a defensive line, Johnson's got to be very careful that he doesn't make a move and end up falling back to third or fourth or even worse.
Without a doubt, without a doubt. You know, he's a, it's a tough moment to try and accept that, you know, someone's overtaken you, especially for the lead of a tournament. And so he definitely needs to just settle down, just relax.
Well, here's your guy Mellish here in lap 10, and he's got Edgy all over him.
He does. Now's the chance for Mellish to show off those defensive driving skills that he definitely has. You know, I mean, Edgy, though, is no small competitor. Nothing small to hold behind at all. So he's going to have his work cut out here. The best defense, though, of course, is a good offense. And you can see Mellish there just putting down beautiful turn after beautiful turn, trying to maintain that 50-foot gap between the two.
And here they come around those final turns here in lap 10. It's Anto, Johnson, Mellish, and Edgy.
Yeah,
to the final lap.
You know, I mean, there's been some really strong races here in race one. Definitely great things to take away from this first race. You know, Johnson, very, very strong. But Anto, look at his form. Brilliant.
You know, we talked about that off the starting grid. This race is all about patience and perseverance. And no one gave more than that than Anto up front. And although Johnson led for a majority of the race, when the opportunity, you know, came available for Anto, he made the move and stuck with it, and he's done a good job holding off. And now the battle between third and fourth. Mellish trying to close the door.
Beautiful on the left foot there from Mellish. See him trail breaking it in front of Eggy's car, and that's wide.
Not wide. And there's a little bit of rubbing.
That's it. Mellish there. Yeah, trying to regain his line. Edgy already had it. It was already his territory. Mellish, I think, should have left a little bit more racing room there. And Eggy's right to take that. Unfortunately, though, we're seeing Mellish fall back now, I think, to fifth behind TX3, Mr. Jack.
Yeah, so Edgy moves up into three. Anto, Johnson, Edgy is your top three right now. And it looks like the way it is going to stay.
And that's Anto taking the checkered flag.
Johnson will be second, and then here's Edgy coming around, trying to make it third.
There it is, just crossing the line there. With Mr.
Jack moves into fourth. He made a last second move on Mellish, who after getting overtaken in that third position, falls back to fifth. Shelby ninth, Warrior 10th, and of course, we're going to get a look at the unofficial race results here before we go into adjudication.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's good to see that these guys have, you know, managed to string together more or less a clean first race. I don't think there's going to be a lot of action from the stewards there. At the same time, though,
we saw little bumps, and of course, we can't see it all. You know, sometimes, you know, things happen in the further back in the race. You know, we're up front, we're watching all the action as folks are, you know, jostling for those top three spots, and sometimes there's some rubbing back there. Really want to know what happened to Vita. That's one that we missed.
Yeah, exactly. To me, it looked like he ran out on the outside curve of turn one. Gets very bumpy out there, and you can easily lose the back of the car. I think I saw him spinning around, didn't quite get the camera there in time. Yeah, I mean, it's always tough to see.
Who do you think is more disappointed, Johnson with losing that number one position or your guy Mellish, who had worked up in the third and ended up finishing fifth?
You know, I think for his first competition race, Mellish has put in a very strong result. I don't think he should be unhappy with that at all. Johnson as well, you know, I think he'll be unhappy with anything but a win after that race. You know, he had pole. He had a brilliant starting position, just needed to convert it. Didn't quite happen for him, but at the same time, second isn't a lot to complain about. It's a great result.
Well, Anto kept asking the questions on every turn. He kept asking the question. Johnson had done a nice job closing the door and then pulling away from him on a majority of those turns.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, Anto just waited, saw his opportunity, and held on for first.
Exactly, and you know, one of the techniques of a great racer. You know, Anto's somebody we haven't seen racing at the very front of the Forza RC before. We've seen him mid-pack. And it's good to see him having that patience, holding on, waiting, and just waiting for a tiny mistake from Johnson. That's all it takes. You know, just a little inch offline, and you can sneak the nose of a Porsche up there.
Yeah, you know, when in those vehicles, we talked about it, you know, it's not P-class. It's not, you know, it's not souped up where you can, you know, really create some separation. Yeah. Most of the packs stay together. I mean, we had one and two separate themselves a little bit. Three and four were sorted in their pack, but then it was 5 through 12 really, you know, working around this track.
Exactly, and it was rough stuff at the back there. It's always tough to drive in a pack. You have to change your braking markers. You have to slow down a little bit more because, a car can jump up at you very quickly when it's decelerating. So, yeah, I mean, they made it through. I'm sure there's always some complaints. You know, when you've got a pack like that, there's always a bit of jostling. But as you say, these aren't Formula One cars. These aren't P-class cars just yet tonight. They're not going to fall apart if you have a little bit of a bump.
Well, I think that's where the adjudication process comes in. We had a tight race between one and two, a tight race between three and four. Did you see anything out there that would say, maybe some things might be changed?
I'd want to see what happened with Vita. If somebody else poked him at that point, if there was a little bit of a nudge mid-corner, I think it was actually Mellish sitting behind him. not naming any names. But you know,
he was in fourth at that moment. It was a 3-4 battle.
Exactly.
We had jumped up to see what was going on with Anto and Johnson, and next thing we know, Vita's finding himself almost all the way back in the back of the pack.
And, you know, when someone loses out that badly, when you lose out and you're running in a good position, it's very difficult. It's something difficult for the marshals to ignore, is what I should say. And so it makes a very good case for having a penalty.
Well, let's take a look at those provisional results here at the end of race number one. It will be Anto on top, Johnson, Eggy, Mr. Jack making a last-second move over Mellish, Kaiser Wolf, Diesel, the Campbell, Shelby, Warrior, Vita, and Utide. Rounding out the 12. Any surprises?
And so at the front there, I didn't think he had it in him. Good on him. You know, great result to start out with. I thought Johnson would have that wrapped up. Diesel is very, very fast, deserves to be higher up in seventh position, as does Lee Campbell, Shelby. I mean, you can just run down the list. They're all such top players. You don't expect to see them at the back.
Worth noting here, Kaiser Wolf started at 11th. So he made one of the biggest moves of the race all the way up to 6th. Disappointed probably his starting grid position, but starting going from 11 to 6, got to be pleased at least with that effort.
That's what the racing route is all about as well. You know, it's about showing those chops on the track, being able to throw the moves in, push through a pack. You know, in a way, if you qualify at the front, you can hot lap it. You know, you can just run away with the race. But that's exactly what we want to see here at the racing route.
Well, Anto is currently number one, Johnson in two. We'll see how that works itself out through this adjudication process. But as you mentioned, once Anto got in front, he was just out there racing by himself, able to take it. And so we're going to step away from a moment. We got a lap comparison with my main man, Allie, and we'll be right back for the final results.
This week's race qualification took drivers from around the world to the high-speed turns and challenging elevations of the Bernese Alps Club Circuit. Managing oversteer was the order of the day, with 605 horsepower hooked onto the rear wheels of the 2003 Porsche Carrera GT, this was no easy task. So let's see what we can learn from the two competitors who have shined in Season 3 of the Forza Racing Championship. TX3 Paps and Car Harmonic, leaders in the EMEA and North American Championships respectively, were able to put together near perfect laps. With their time separated by only 0.007 of a second, this will be a study in tiny margins. Jumping on board as the two head into turn one, you can see them hooking up for a double apex here, and already Harmonic has landed the first blow. Let's pause it there, because you can see on the right hand side of the screen, Car Harmonic has hooked in that second apex where TX3 Paps has failed to rotate the car and has just run a car width wide, letting it go again. We can see that Harmonic is able to put down that power. Look at the pedestrian sign. See, it's just slightly closer for Car Harmonic, able to apply that power slightly faster on the way out of turn one. Both are going to feather the throttle through turn two and head up to a very tricky apex left-hander here at turn three. Both will have to correct over the ridge there. Two corrections for Harmonic. I don't think that will hurt his speed, because as we head down here, down the hill, you can see, look at the shadow of that tree, Harmonic is still a car length ahead. Now, the two of them are going to head into this very, very complex set of fast-flowing corners that is the middle sector of this track. A little bit of a correction there for Harmonic, but it's not going to hurt him too badly at all. Both of them pushing with full commitment now through the tunnel and coming out on the other side. Harmonic's going to keep that lead. This is a very tricky braking zone now. Through the left-hander, don't run too wide. The track limit there is the yellow line, and the two of them now into this left-hander. Let's take another look. You can see Car Harmonic has maintained that one car length lead throughout that middle section. But check out the left-hand side of this screen. TX3 Paps has set himself up on the left-hand side of the road. He's now going to be able to power down with a little bit more confidence through the right-hander, which is coming up next. Let's have a look at that, release it again, and we're off. The two of them setting off through that right-hander, and Paps is carrying just a tiny amount more speed, and he's going to keep that all the way up the hill, over the jump, and now pausing it once again. You can see the two are neck and neck. Look at the shadow of that tree just up ahead, perhaps even an inch or so ahead. Both of them pretty similar here through the chicane into final turn. I mean, Harmonic's a little bit deeper, not very much at all, and then powering down towards the finish line once again, and it's going to be so, so close between these two. Let's pause it at the line, and you can see that is what 0.007 of a second looks like at this speed. Amazingly close stuff. It's great to see what we can learn from the tiny margins at the top of this incredible season of the Forza Racing Championship. The announcement of an offline final at the 24 Hours of Le Mans truly seems to have lit a fire beneath a few of those lids. So, with the final round of qualification kicking off from Monday the 22nd of May, be sure to throw your hat in the ring by registering to race at forzarc.gfinity.net and navigating to the Porsche menu on Forza Motorsport 6 to find the latest qualification challenge.
It started as a legend, one of the greatest of all.
A thousand years we've kept it hidden.
To protect Earth from what was destined to arrive.
Optimus Prime, you destroyed your home. Do you seek redemption?
My maker, I do.
Your daughter, what would you say to her?
Brush your teeth, work hard. Stay away from any boy in a band, especially a drummer.
These are troubled times. Without leaders, chaos reigns. Two worlds colliding. You're all that stand in its way.
And now the greatest mission of them all, to turn the tide of human history.
Destruction of everything we know and love begins.
I'm not leaving you.
When all seems lost, a few brave souls can save everything we've ever known.
The operation is over.
We're not giving up on Prime, okay?
I want to stay, and I want to fight them.
For my world to live, yours must die.
They called it madness. Building the car of your dreams yourself. Madness. Putting the engine in the back. Madness. Launching a turbocharged super sports car in the midst of a worldwide oil crisis. Madness. Taking a sports car into the desert and taking the insights gained there back onto the streets. madness. Building the first hybrid car on Earth. And when its time had come, the fastest one on Earth. Once more, they called it madness. Let them call it madness. We call it courage. The courage to build a sports car with four business class seats. The courage to upgrade not only the driving, but also the driver. The courage to transfer an unmistakable design DNA and create a luxury saloon that was born on the racetrack and is at home on the roads. The new Panamera. Courage changes everything.
And welcome back here live from London. We have the results for that first matchup here. Scott Cole, you're dumb American. You're smart British voice, Ali Tack here. And well, the first race is in the books. We do have those results ready for you. And I tell you what, really nothing changed. You know, R. Kelly is okay with a little bumping and grinding. There was just a few warnings in there, but it remains the same. Anto Johnson, Eggy, Mr. Jack, and Mellish are your top five.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, as you say, R. Kelly's fine with bumping and grinding.
We're not okay.
But our marshals are not, exactly. So these were all for bumps on other drivers. It's not for track extensions or other bits and bobs like that. Nobody consistently running over the edge of the track. It's all for being a little bit too aggressive in car-on-car moments. So you can see there Mr. Jack taking a penalty alongside Kaiser Wolf, Shelby Warrior, and U-Tight, all those guys. Just a bit too punchy.
Yeah, and Vita's got to be the one that's sick to his stomach. He was up there in third place, could have had 15 points. You end up going donuts, bagels, all the way down at 11.
Yeah, exactly. A shame, and you can see, you know, he hasn't got a warning next to his name.
No, we have no idea. We have no idea what happened. We just smoked tires. He was just spinning around next thing, you know. He's back in 11. Really a shame for him because through majority of the race, he raced very cleanly.
He did, and he was, you know, running well in third position as well. It was really good to see him, you know, just coming out of the blocks like that with a strong performance. You know, I mean, we've seen that there was a little bit of punchiness around in the race, though, and you can get nervous. All sorts of different things can happen, and just a mistake there, one way or the other, and it's punished him.
Anto was probably the guy that raced the cleanest through those 11 laps, and we talked about it, that patience, that perseverance. He just was able to hang back and wait for Johnson to make a mistake. And really, you know, for Anso, who only had to lead those last four laps, it's a bit tougher for Johnson to lead those seven laps, and then Anto just able to move in at the right time, right place.
I know, it's a horror of racing, isn't it? You know, it only counts at one point in the race what position you're in, you know? You can be leading up until the last corner if you like. It still doesn't make a difference if someone overtakes you before the line. It's how it goes. I mean, Johnson, yeah, he'll have to do a stronger job next time out defending that pole position because he will start on pole here for the second race as well.
All right, well, let's take a look at race number two, where we're headed.
Here we go. Off to VIR.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Off in Virginia. Nice big fields here. Plenty of space for the people to fall off the track. So you have to make sure that you stay on the black stuff.
Yeah, and the 919 is going to be the car. What a gorgeous hybrid from Porsche.
I love it. I love all the little aerodynamic gubbins they stick on it, you know. It's like a little mathematical problem looking at it and trying to work out how the air flows over it. Really amazing, amazing machinery. It's a car on Forza, which really likes low revs. So you're going to see a lot of high gears here from the drivers, just controlling the amount of torque that they're producing.
Yeah, really that electric motor, about 55 to 60% is from a naturally inspired motor. And then the electric motor kicks in with the rest of that 400. And this is going to be a tough track. You know, you and I were here early running through this one a little bit and looking at some of those pressure points. What's some of the turns that you think we should look out for here?
Yeah, turn two and three here called NASCAR. That's a long double left-hander. You're going to go full power into the first apex, brake on it, and into the second apex. It's very difficult to pull off well. Later on, the snake, I mean, we were having a bit of fun there because that car does not want to stay on the
track. No, it doesn't. You know, this P-Class, once you really put the hammer down, and you think that's some time that you're going to make up some time, you're going to make up some positioning. The next thing you know, you get toward the end of that, and it gets really squirrely.
It does, and you can feel it, you know, especially when you have it in low revs and a high gear, this car just pulls, and it just gets scary because you're going from 60 miles an hour all the way up to 160 in a very, very short period of time.
And it's so very tempting to get maybe a little bit up on the curb, maybe a little bit into the grass as we're ready to go. So watch for that, though. Watch for them to try to get there. Johnson up front, Anto in second. There is Eggy in third. Fourth position, Diesel, who needs a strong finish. Did not look good in race number one. Mr. Jack, able to recover. He had a nice finish. There's Vita, who dropped all the way to 11. See if he can make move. And Lee Campbell. Any dark horse on VIR? Any P-class all-stars here?
You know, I think Mellish has been practicing this a lot. From what I hear, he's really been putting in the hours here on the 919. So it'll be interesting to see what he can do around VIR. At the same time, though, you know, we're not seeing a frame or harmonic. So no full-on P-class specialists here, which makes life a little bit easier. Let's see if we can hop back immediately, though, just to Vita here in sixth position.
Yeah, so eight laps here on VIR. And I tell you what, they're going to be some tough laps as they come flying around that first turn.
Yeah, Johnson just taking a little bump there from Anto in turn one. Yeah, he was lucky to keep that car in a straight line.
So stacking up here, you can see Warrior trying to move to the inside. So I tell you what, right off the bat here in lap one, our marshals are already going to have their handful with these P-classes on VIR. By the way, some gorgeous Porsche commercials during the break. I already had some friends and family from America say, that Panamera Turbo, that's my next car.
Look at that. Shelby a little bit close there to Mellish, and both of them run off track and up seventh place off track as well. So that's a nice opportunity there for Vida to sneak by on two positions up to eighth. Now onto this very, very long straight for the first time this race.
Warrior already looking better than he did in the first race course. Different track, different class of car. Mellish all the way down to ninth, Kaiserwolf in 10th. But surprise, surprise, up at the front, you have Johnson and Anto. And wow, a huge collision. And Vita will fall back to eighth. Kaiserwolf will move up to eighth, still falling back to 10th. And so Vita was the story of our first race, and he's already become one of the main characters in race number two.
What a massive, massive crash. I mean, it was such a hard impact that it's making me think maybe...
He's got to go to the pits.
Yeah, he's going to have to jump straight into the pits. So Pro Warrior, that's the guy who Vita bumped into there. And, you know, what a massive impact.
So
was he breaking a little bit early maybe? Hard to know.
With all that going on, Diesel was able to pass Eggy, so now he's moved up into second. Anto has fallen all the way back to fifth. Not sure what happened with him, with us mainly focused on Vita and his accident. And so now it's Johnson up in front, Mr. Jackson fourth, Anto's in fifth, Campbell all the way back in sixth place. And you can see third through fifth in a pretty move there by Anto, but he's going to do a little bit of lawn work himself. Allie, it seems like these racers are really struggling with keeping that P-Class 919 on the track.
You know, one of the challenges of the Forza Racing Championship is jumping from car class to car class. We saw them in an S-class car last time out. A lot more forgiving in the braking zones. You know, if you're just a tenth of a second too late on the brakes in this kind of a car, you're going to be traveling all the way through Virginia on that 919 rather than staying on the track.
And if you think that's a tough adjustment, we'll be in a C-class in our final race of the day here on the Europe side. We're in week three of the Forza Racing Championship, season three, Porsche Cup, the road to Le Mans. Of course, that's June 17th and 18th, and that's where these drivers are trying to find themselves as Anto trying to keep Campbell off of him in that fifth position.
Yeah, those two running super close to one another. We see Anto here. Is Campbell going to close up under brakes as we go into this left-right chicane? Just managing to keep his gap there, Anto. So very impressive stuff from him. Let's hop back to the other camera mode and just check out how it's progressing. All cars now heading down the snake so fast. You want to be flat out through this whole complex of corners. Grit your teeth. Left, right, left. And then at this following left, it's going to be a little bit of braking.
And that's South Bend. That's where they all funnel down to. And you have the tendency, you want to stay on the throttle, but if you do, you're going to find yourself off in the grass.
Exactly, exactly. You know, you feel confident. These left, right, left, it lets you flow. It lets you start to feel as though the car's really coming to you. And if you try and take that final turn 10, as you say, South Bend, you try and take that flat, you are not going to be staying on the track at all. And this is what it's all about, keeping your nose clean here, because that is how you string great results together.
17 turns, 3.3 miles is this Virginia International Raceway, and we're in lap number three of race number two. I tell you what, Anto started off in the second position, and he's got a lot of work to do now.
He definitely does, but you can see him on the back of Eggy here, just thrusting now into turn one. Eggy's going to take that defensive line. And look at that. Lee Campbell's done both of them. Anto and Eggy coming together at turn one. What do you think of that?
Big time collision from Anto as we jump on board with him. So Mellish fifth, but Anto is the man that's on the move. And if he's got to take some carnage with him to make advancement happen, Anto has proved he can do so.
Exactly. And, you know, it's a sign of a strong racer. It's a sign of somebody who really wants it. We saw Anto making that move very patiently on Johnson in race one, but not quite find that patience here in race two, and it has cost him. So, yeah, I mean, yeah, it's a lesson learned.
He's quite a bit away from Mellish here as he gets off in the grass again. And, boy, Anto looked really strong in race number one, taking home that checkered flag. But here in race number two, it's been some bumping and grinding and a lot of work off in the grass for Anto.
So I just want to highlight, if I can, position 12 here. That's Pro Warrior 01. Not someone I'm aware of or have seen before in this racing.
It's way always, back there.
Yeah, I mean, it's tough, isn't it? You know, you look at like a 2,900-foot disadvantage from the leader, and it can look bad. It can look like you're not fast. Everyone here is very, very fast, I assure you. It's very, very difficult to get into the weekly finals here at the Forza Racing Championship. We saw that coming together that Pro Warrior had with Vida earlier on, and that must have just put a stopper on his race. So it's sad to see, but hopefully he'll come back strong in race three.
So he's all the way back at number 12. We'll hop on board here with Lee Campbell, who's moved himself up into fourth place, trying to hold off Mellish. He's got Mr. Jack also in his sights, and it's been Johnson up front, but Mellish is just right behind him, trying to pass him. Here in lap number five, here on Virginia International Raceway.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, these two have been having such a ding-dong battle. It's been great to see Mellish and Lee Campbell swapping places over and over. I've got to say, though, if you look backwards there on the left-hand side of the screen, you can see sixth position, Bam Anto. He's 300 feet behind, and that is coming down. Every single time these two get tangled up, Anto is catching up.
Let's go back there to the backside with Anto. See him. You can see his statistics and information on board with him there. He's currently running fifth. But as you said, that fastest lap continues to improve. He's just pushed it a little bit too hard at times. And, you know, we talked about how brilliant his patience was in our first race. But here in race number two. He's, you know, he's proven that it's been a bit tough for him
without
to overcome.
Without doubt. You know, it's so easy to do as well, to push just a little bit too hard. Look at that, Mellish pushing the braking zone a little bit hard there on Lee Campbell. Those two coming together, it's not going to hurt them. But once again, every time this happens, I look down to the left there. Anto is loving it. He's rubbing his hands together because he can get through here. Lee Campbell wide there through NASCAR. That's a tricky part of the track.
Yeah, he talked about it off the stop. Able to go through there in sixth gear. Haven't seen a lot of overtaking as the battle between fourth and fifth place continues. Mellish hot on the heels of Lee Campbell, and he talked about it. Wouldn't be surprised there if these two get tangled and you see Anto go flying by.
Agreed. Agreed. Absolutely. Anto, yeah, he showed a little bit of impatience earlier on in this race, but we've seen the patience that he does have. We've seen that in race one. Able to just bide his time, apply the pressure. And that's what he's doing right now. He's just hooking up those apexes, making those laps work, making them fast. And then he's hoping to move past Lee Campbell and Mellish if they come together.
Vita all the way back at number 11 after his second squirrely moment of the day. Had him falling from 5 to 11. As you can see, Mellish trying to make a move. We're not showing you a lot of Johnson because Johnson's just way out in front right now on the seventh lap.
He's such a machine, Johnson, doing so well. We saw it week one as well on this track. Johnson just walked away with it. He's got something special around Virginia. Johnson loves it around VIR. So good to see. Able to put down those lap times again, able to move away. And, you know, if I'm not mistaken, he's dropped everybody else. It's just Johnson on his own.
Jump up to third place. There's Mr. Jack. He's trying to chase down Diesel, and we haven't seen a lot of Diesel either, but it's because Johnson and Diesel have been running so clean there in that one and two position.
It is. Those two just running super close to one another. Just saw super close to one another's pace, I should say. Here we are, though, on board with Mellish following Lee Campbell through the snake. I love it. You see how much downforce these cars generate when you really see them at speed like that, just gripping up on that left, right, left.
Going past the oak tree that used to be there back in 2013. Turn their way down the back straight, and you can see that's where Lee Campbell starting to pull away a little bit from Mellish.
He is. Mellish there unable to really get the most out of that 919's acceleration. You know, attempting to put down all that power onto the track is no easy task whatsoever, especially in a car that weighs just 1,900 pounds and has 900 horsepower.
Well, coming around here to lap number 8, and we'll show you out in front. There's the man, Johnson, who led for the majority of the first race for 7 of the 11 laps, but here in this one, he's been all the way out front. A little wire-to-wire finish for Johnson if he can hold it together.
It's great to see. I love that Gaming Libertines paint as well. Johnson, of course, a member of that streaming community. And, yeah, he's a super-fast competitor. It'd be good to stay on board with him if we can. Maybe hop forward once again to Johnson as he passes through this final lap, because he is so dominant around this track.
He's really been out in front since the get-go, and he's coming around.
Look at that, just down that main straight.
Got a huge lead. He's already pushed out to about 2,000 feet over Diesel, who, let's be honest, Diesel's running an incredible race himself. He's just had no one out in front to be able to draft up with or battle with. He's sort of been racing his own race.
Full respect to Johnson here, though. He is just absolutely in a class of his own around this track. Brilliant stuff.
So a huge lead, and he will bring it around and slide in awesome fashion, and he will take unofficially race number 2. Finished second in our first race, and now taking the checkered by a large margin as we come down to the final moments in this one. It's Campbell, Anto, Edgy in 7th, Kaiserwolf in 8th, Shelby down at the bottom, but you got to tip your cap to Johnson, Diesel, Mr. Jack. Those are your top three provisionally here through race number two. And boy, you talked about it. Just a dominating performance by Johnson.
So good to see, you know, a competitor who has been around for a long time, but it's been tough to see him languishing a little bit maybe in the mid-pack in these racing tournaments. So definitely now coming back and just staking his claim in this tournament.
The impressive thing about that is losing the lead to Anto in the first race, but really not carrying that over to race number two. He's like, well, you know, I missed my opportunity to take the checkered in the first one, but he comes back and says, you know what? I'm gonna race my race, and a 2-1, if it holds up, is not a bad start to week number three.
You've got to brush it off. Exactly. You know, losing out there to Anto, it was a good move by Anto in that first race. It was a strong, you know, and we saw once he got ahead of Johnson, he could build that gap. Johnson, though, you know, he could have let that hurt him. He could have let that damage his pace later on in the competition, but he hasn't. He's come straight back strong, taking the victory.
Yeah, Anto started in second, fell all the way back to sixth. And I think that's the other difference, too, is no disrespect to Diesel because he finished second and ran a good race, but there was really no one like Anto up there to push Johnson, make him uncomfortable. He was basically at that point just running hot laps.
Incredible, wasn't it? Incredible. And it's so good to see how much faster he is. You know, it's always excellent to see a dominant competitor, I think.
Yeah.
And he's really just come out in season three. I've said this earlier on in the cast, but he's come out in season three so dominant. And so I hope he can take this form all the way to Le Mans.
And now that the finals is a live event, it's good to see. Not only are you have to be good online, but then when you finally get to Le Mans in France on June 17th and 18th, you got to back that up. And Johnson's the kind of competitor that I think will thrive well in both the online and the live final situation.
I agree. I mean, he's been around offline competitions before.
Right?
He's done it before. For all of you guys maybe haven't tried an offline competition before, Le Mans might be your first. It's a different kettle of fish, you know. It's sweaty. It's tough. And the pressure is super, super high.
Well, we're waiting to see the final results here. But provisionally, it is Johnson in first. Number two was Diesel, and three was Mr. Jack. And we didn't talk a lot about Diesel or Mr. Jack, but those guys, two and three, really ran clean. The biggest battle was actually your guy, Mellish, who just seems to keep mixing it up here in his first two races.
Yeah, exactly. A great battle between Mellish and Lee Campbell there for a number of laps. Those two running at what looked like a very, very similar pace, but I think had very different sort of talents on track. You could see around certain corners, Lee Campbell certainly had the advantage. Around others, Mellish didn't. That's why we saw so much position swapping between those two guys dancing around.
Another disappointing finish for Vita, who looked really good in the semifinals, was in the third position. Once again, gets a little squirrely, gets off on the side. Next thing you know, it's another double-digit finish for him down in 11.
Exactly, and it's the other side of the coin of what we were talking about with Johnson with Vita. You know, you can have an upset in your first race, and you can let that affect you as the races continue. Johnson hasn't. He's one overtaken. He's just like, yeah, whatever. I'm going straight out. I'm going to win the next thing. Vita, on the other hand, it looks like it's upset him. It looks like he's off his rhythm right now. Can he change it around for the third race? Yeah, that's what we're going to have to wait and see.
By the way, on my way over to the event, this is my first time here in London, and here's the provision. I'll tell you that story later. So Johnson first, Diesel second, Mr. Jack, Lee Campbell, who actually really made a good move up to fourth. Mellish will be fifth. Anto will be sixth. Edgy Kaiserwolf moves up to eighth. Shelby at ninth. Utight, after that number 12 finish, finds himself in 10. Vita, once again, has doubled up to 11. And then Warrior, just not his day.
Not his day. Not his day on the track. Warrior, you know, he got punted. There's no other way for it by Vita. It's tough to say. I mean, in the race, it was hard to call whose fault that was.
Right.
On the one hand, Warrior may have been on the brakes way, way, way too early. And there's a trust between drivers. There has to be that we're going to have a shared braking zone. You know, so if he broke early, that's his fault, you know. But at the same time, it did look like a bit of a punt, right?
Well, I'll tell you some more American in London experience from a big guy. Well, okay, we'll save that for later. We do have a hot lap coming up here with Allie. And, of course, we'll come back with your final results of race number two.
With the third and final chance to qualify for the Forza Racing Championship race route opening on Monday, May the 22nd, racers looking to secure their place in an incredible offline final at the 2017 24 Hours of Le Mans will be throwing in times like nobody's business. So let's take an early look at a track and car combination that seems bound to be the focus of some amazing competition. The Porsche 911 AG GT1 98 took first and second in the 1998 24 Hours of Le Mans. In doing so, it gave Porsche a record-breaking 16th overall win at this jewel in the crown of endurance racing competitions. With a high-revving, turbocharged flat six producing 550 brake horsepower, this dedicated racer is no slouch. And with that incredible aerodynamic design, cornering speeds are astonishing. Racers will be navigating this car through the highly technical Sebring Raceway in Florida, so I jumped behind the wheel to have a look at the challenges this track offers. Full speed down the main straight, and you want to tuck all the way to the right. Look for the end of the pit wall. That's your break point. That's your turn in. Here we are, throwing it into turn one, one downshift. Release the steering as the power comes in, and we're heading now down towards turn two. Spot that 200 marker, on the brakes again, and down into second gear. Keep it slow for this slow section of corners. The lighter cement on the inside of turn four, that's where the grip is. Accelerate out, manage that oversteer. Now I'm running normal steering, no traction control, and a manual gearbox. No need for a clutch in a GT car, it's got the shift speed already. Now we're spotting that 300 marker, hit the brakes all the way down to first gear. I'm gonna run over the curb just a little bit and get that wrong on the way out of the corner. Look at all that correction. There is time to be found in that corner for me, and it's flat out now down this curving straight, and once again looking for the brake marker, 300 and down to second gear. Push that corner apex speed as much as you can into the left-hander, a short shift here just to control that power, and then we're up towards the middle sector of this track. Braking now into the right-hander, trail brake onto the apex, accelerate out, watch out for the curb on the outside. Your car will bounce all over that, and it's full commitment into this double left-hander. Just as little steering input as you can will carry that speed down into second here. Again, avoid the curb, but as close as you can get to it. Second gear all the way through this section. Extend on the left-hand side here and bring it in for that apex. Carry all the speed you can. You need every mile an hour for this straight. Just push through the gears, get the revs right up there, and you'll find yourself in fourth gear now. Hold fourth, no need to use fifth. And this is gonna be a bit crazy into the final bend. Throw it in there, no brakes, brake at the apex right there, pushing into third gear, hold the rear of that car and just hold all the speed you possibly can. A little bit of a kick from me there under power, and it's a straight line now along the backside of this straight and to the finish line. To take part in this qualification challenge and race for championship points on Sunday the 28th of May, jump over to forzarc.gfinity.net and register with your gamer tag. From Monday the 22nd to Wednesday the 24th, you can set your time around Sebring in the GT1 98. And if you're fast enough, you could be racing next Sunday for your place at an incredible offline final at the 24 Hours of Le Mans.
Do you? joyful cry. Give me a
Hey, welcome back. Race two, finally in the books. Got race number three coming up. Scott Cole along with Allie Tack. And Allie, did you see anything there that you thought maybe the Marshals would sink their teeth into?
Yeah, I mean, we saw Vida, didn't we, having a very, very tough time getting through cleanly on a few of the other guys. So, yeah, tough to know. Here we are, though, with the Marshall report.
Yeah, here we go. Final results for race number two. Johnson stays on for first. Diesel, Mr. Jack, Lee Campbell, Mellish, Anto. But you look down there, Kaiser Wolf with a five-second penalty. He got jiggy with it. And then Vida, come on now. Salt in the wounds as he made contact with Eggy and then Warrior. So, Not so bad for Warrior. He gets to move up to 11, but it's still donut points.
It's donut points. As you say, zero altogether. I mean, it's one of the great shames of racing, isn't it? That you can't give back the points that someone loses. You know, you can penalize the guy who's done wrong, but there's nothing you can do to help out somebody who's lost out illegitimately.
One of the disappointing things for me has been Kaiser Wolf. You know, a guy that we got to know in New York. I thought he was going to come out and have a strong showing today. Looked pretty decent in the semis, but it struggled. And you saw the five-second penalty from them drops him down to ninth.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Kaiser Wolf, you know, we've seen has been somebody throughout the seasons who's had periods of being incredible at the top of his game and has had slumps as well. And I wonder whether season three is starting to look like a little bit of a slump for Kaiser Wolf, but we'll find out all of this later on, of course, once all the results are tallied up.
Yeah, race number three coming up. We already have two in the books. We're in week three of the Forza Racing Championship, Road to Le Mans. Wow, we're just a few weeks away from getting ourselves to France, and that's during the Le Mans race. That's going to be the cool thing about it is we're going to have some awesome Forza racing going on and some awesome Le Mans at the same time.
Incredible, isn't it? You know, just such a test of endurance, the Le Mans 24-hour. I mean, yeah, it's such a dream that this competition would be going there.
Love the movie.
Love the movie.
Love the movie. I watch the race every year. I mean, I'm a big JDM guy, obviously own a few Porsches. And I'll be honest, I have a little bit in my heart. You know, I'm the big fat American guy, so Corvette racing in there as well has a special place in my heart. The number three car, come on.
You know, I'm Ferrari through and through. Cut me and I bleed red, Scott. Cut me and I bleed red. It's all about those 488s. Oh, well, I like you so much.
I just came from California, so I don't know. It's been like 40 hours, and I've slept two in the last 40 hours, but tons of great Ferraris out there and Porsches and just unbelievable cars. But, you know, for me, I'm just the American stereotype, and chat can always have fun with that on Beam and Twitch. I'm cool with it, but none worse than me walking over here to the studio. Big fat guy, got my jacket on, got Atlanta Braves hat, which is a baseball team in the U.S., and what am I carrying? Got my McDonald's in the hand. I'm drinking my Coca-Cola.
That's right.
I'm as stereotypical as you can get. Like, oh, look at this American guy.
Mug me quick, written across your back. I think that was right there.
No. Of course, we're just right around the corner from Chelsea FC, who's having their final match of the year before a big FA Cup. And so it's a cool. London's very cool.
Yeah.
You know, I've been here several times, but really, I haven't stayed in this area of Chelsea, London. You know, it's not really your touristy type. There, you know, you can't see the London Bridge or you know, Big Ben or Parliament. So we've had two races thus far. Johnson's looked really good. He finished second in race number one, just behind Anto, and then so dominant in race number two. And here's the leaderboard thus far through our first two races here. Johnson is on top with that first and second place finishes. Anto struggled in race number two, so just 8 points, but he's still six ahead of Mr. Jack Diesel. Eggy, Mellish, any surprises in there, or do you think things are ironing out the way that they should?
You know, at the top there, Johnson, Anto, Mr. Jack, pure class. All those drivers, Diesel as well, and Eggy. You know, what am I saying? You can't just cut off at any point within this leaderboard. It's good to see Mellish up there doing well. Sixth position with Lee Campbell.
10 points behind. You know, just 2 6th place finishes in a row, and it could have been better for Mellish.
Yeah,
he looked really good in the early to mid part of the races. Has struggled finishing. He could actually be in third or fourth place right now, and there's Diesel just sneakingly, after a poor performance in race one, comes back in race two, and now he's in shouting distance. If he can somehow come up with a victory here in the final one, he could be pushing for one of those top three spots.
Yeah, he definitely could. FCT are a great team as well. You know, I was checking out the recreational leaderboards over on Forza Horizon 3. FCT are dominating that as well. That team is straddling the divide between Motorsport 6 and Horizon 3. You know, good to see it happening.
And we are just a stone's throw away from Forza Motorsport 7. So I know the Forza community is really awaiting that release. And with Le Mans and that coming down the pipe, I'm hoping at E3. I'm going to go to E3. Hopefully I get to see a little bit of Scorpio and all the new graphics that are coming down the pipe.
Yeah, no, it looks incredible, doesn't it? Just the small little sneak peeks that start coming out. It's such a long tease, you know? But definitely looking forward to it.
Well, no one cares about what we have to say. All they care about is race number three is coming your way, folks. And I tell you what, this is a tough track. Only 1.8 miles, and they're going to get a little bit. Oh, boy, this is going to be a tough vehicle to take around this track.
Yeah, it's 1.8 miles, as you say, but it feels like a lot longer. This car is, you know, it's a great, it's a classic Porsche, a beauty. I think.
Well, tell, love it.
Yeah. And, you know, I think designed and built so that they could homologate a race car in sort of Category 5, which was GT cars back then. And it became a classic. The suspension, though, these days, compared to maybe a modern sports car, might feel a little bit on the soft side. You might even accuse it of being wallowy.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking about a car that was produced in 1982. A lot of improvements. Especially to handling over the years. But I'm telling you, for 1982, this car was an absolute gem for these guys to drive. And we are ready to go. Let's head to Spain as Johnson, Anto, and there is Edgy in third. Fourth, well, Diesel will take on that fourth. He needs a good finish to move all the way up. Mr. Jack has looked strong. Any dark horses as we head to Spain?
This car, I think, it's anyone's game, really. It's going to be chaos a little bit. It's going to be a lot of rubbing, I think, and it's going to be about keeping your nose clean. I'd just like to say, though, I absolutely love some of the vintage liveries that are coming out for this last Porsche of the night. Always great to see the painters just going to town.
Yeah, looking strong. There's Warrior at the back. And we are ready, set, to go here. 14 laps. What corner should we be looking out for here?
Yeah, this first bend that we're coming on into is a right-hand hairpin. Very, very slow indeed as Lee Campbell pushes through the middle of two other drivers there. Here we go. Hopefully they can stay more or less clean. It's not happened. Diesel spinning.
Oh, wow. Big time. Collision. Moving through their alley and well, we thought that would be a tough turn, and it proved out to be so.
It's so tricky. You know, you just can't push through there. If you're in a crowd of cars, you just have to just get off, brake way too early, and absolutely just coast the car through there. You cannot push. We saw, you know, there's a lot of people who want to succeed in this lobby. This hasn't worked out this time around.
So Edgy in sixth. There's Vita all the way back in 11. I mean, it is absolutely not been his day.
Exactly. Vida, you know, losing out again. Eggy there taking a pump from, Mr. Jack. So just tough to see.
Yeah, a lot of action here moving already in lap number one. And all piled up here in Spain. And tell you what, Warrior trying to hold off Mr. Jack. And that's one guy that you're going to have a tough time with. He's really trying to get around this track. There's Shelby up in eight, Lee Campbell in seven, Eggy in sixth.
Yeah, you say Warrior and Mr. Jack having a battle there, both fighting out for ninth position. We're just hopping on board here with TX3, Mr. Jack, as they head down the main straight. I mean, a little bit of a gap this time around. Let's get a distance read on that. There you go. You can see 120 feet appearing. At the same time, that's at full speed, and there's a lot of mistakes out wide there. Mellish now trying to re-enter the track. Does a good job to not cut across Mr. Jack's line. This has just condensed this battle up ahead, absolutely. You can see it runs all the way, I think, to third position.
Yeah, 3-4-5 is really starting to stack up here. Kaiserwolf making his best push of the day. Did not look well in race one and two, but here in race number three, he's out there in third position. And Utite, really kind of his best push of the day. And I tell you what, this is a lot different. You go from a P-class all the way down to a C-class car, and Utite trying to hold on with Lee Campbell, trying to overtake him, but he closes the door. Nice job there by Utite.
Yeah, let's just hop back here to TX3 Shelby. Those three almost going three wide there with Lee Campbell and Utite around that long right-hander. That's amazing to see. Lee Campbell just pestering the rear bumper there of Utite. He doesn't want to let that PPS driver find his rhythm.
Coming around that New Holland turn here on the front side of the track, as we were just two laps into this one already, Allie, and really not a lot of separation. But Johnson looking strong, still out in front. It's just race strong all day, all three of our races. Johnson's looking really good.
Ooh, Shelby there. He's missed his brake marker. He's missed it altogether. You saw him just countersteer, steer away from the corner, and just avoid the car ahead. Just make sure that if he has an accident, it's his fault. He's going to have the accident all by himself. Good driving there from Shelby, making it the best of a bad situation.
Well, we're going to move to the front of the pack here with Anto. And Anto, a familiar scene from race one. Anto trying to chase down Johnson, and talked about that patience that he had in our first race of the day. Gonna have to get up there though. You know, Johnson's the kind of racer that you have to get up there and force him to make some moves.
Yeah, it definitely is. We're gonna jump back here though, just very quickly to 11th place and Warrior, because things are getting crazy.
Yeah, all stacked up here, Allie. 5 through 11, as you see Vida go off in the grass, and he's had some control issues today.
Tough for Vida. Back in 11th now, looking at the rear of this pack. You can just see each and every one of these drivers thinks that they're about to get away with something very, very special. They're all in this lottery that is a very, very tight pack in a very difficult car.
Well, you saw the line there by Warrior, who's we're riding along with in 10th place, and everybody else went wide. He tried to stay inside, and you know, there's a little bit of time lost. So I think right now, Warrior, the best thing that he could do is really try to choose that line, but he's going to try to go inside of Mellish, and there's that time lost. So there's Vito on the outside. And Vito's trying to run a different line here, Allie, and it just hasn't worked out for him today.
You're absolutely right. You can see he's just desperate for it, trying any line that Warrior isn't trying. You know, whatever you choose, I'll go opposite. You go inside, I'll go outside. Anywhere other on the track, I will give it a go. Vida needs to relax. You know, he needs to take his time, work that move, and be very, very patient. Warrior here, though, now he's got the run onto Mellish, into this back hairpin. Mellish tries to defend, but much too late there, so he's going to have to pull off of that line. Little bit of a bump there for Warrior, and now it's three wide into this back section of the track. So, so tough, this racing.
Yeah, any kind of move, any type of rubbing, any bump could find yourselves jumping up three or four spots or losing three or four spots. And right now, Vita just giving Warrior hell. Just all over him. Just giving him absolute hell.
Yeah. There is no way that Warrior's forgotten for a second that Vita is there, and especially after the two of them came together last time out at VIR, Warrior is not going to be altogether too happy to see that it's Vita pestering him.
Well, we'll move into lap number 5 of 14 here in the race, and I tell you what, starting to have a little bit of separation. Johnson way out in front, Anto just cannot close the door, and there's Warrior just getting a bit loose as we keep moving through these turns. And
yeah, you know, Warrior there, you could see him. He wanted to defend that position. He wanted to do his very, very best. It was tough. You know, it's tough to see. Obviously, all these guys driving without a line, without any kind of suggested line, they have to make up their brake markers before these tracks. And that's
But at this point, when you get to this point, you've made it through the semis, you're here on a Sunday here in the finals, you better know your line. You better know, if you don't know your line by now, you're in trouble.
Yeah, it's a great point. It's very true as well. You know, they will have had a lot of practice on these tracks, but the lines, you know, change. The braking points change when you're offline, especially when you're trying to defend or attack another car. And it can take more experience than you can necessarily get in a week to really know where to brake every single time. So a very understandable mistake there from Warrior, but one that sees him at the back of this gaggle of cars.
Johnson well on front, Anto behind him, and we have a little bit of a pile up as Kaiser Wolf is trying to break away from that pack, that 3 through 11 pack, and catch up with Anto. He's actually, as we move up a little bit forward with Kaiser Wolf, he's catching up to Anto a little bit. You just saw we made the cut there that Anto got a little bit onto the dirt, and maybe that'll open the door for Kaiser Wolf. At this point, needs a top finish, as he's not looked good today.
Kaiser Wolf has been doing a great job this race, just keeping his nose clean in front of that pack. You know, just behind Kaiser Wolf here is that battle we've been monitoring. So they're all snapping at his heels, and he's been keeping a very, very cool head, just hooking together lap after lap. We're 6 laps in now of 14, and trying to catch Anto as he goes. So not quite making it there yet. We're just jumping back
jam.
Again now.
That's a log jam right there. And you see Vita. Vita's the guy. I mean, it comes out with the results. You know, he's finished 11th twice. He's a terror. He's just a hell on wheels.
Vita is. He wants
to force
it, doesn't
himself
he?
Through.
You know, you can always tell a tough driver by the amount of dings that their pretty little cars get. And Vita's is one large dent right now. It's been a tough old race for him. He's wanted it. You know, you've got to give him credit for that. You've got to give him the attitude is all there. Mellish, they're losing out on the last
the
quarter.
Curb. Yeah. Off the curb, loses 3 spots. He's now behind Warrior and all the way back to 11 for Mellish. And this is really where the race action is happening. Up in front, there's a bit of a pack. 3-4 is actually Anto still trying to hold off Kaiser Wolf up there. So that's the 3-4-5 battle between Anto, Kaiser Wolf. Some jockeying toward the back, but really the story here again as we're halfway through race number 3 is Johnson just way out in front.
Yeah, he's done a brilliant job. Once again, we're seeing Johnson dominate this race. And it's going to be, you know, just the result of him being able to put those lap times in, just hook them one by one together. You know, a battle like this, the one we're kind of looking at here, it's brilliant to watch. It's great fun to be a part of, but it's not the way you're going to set the fastest lap times. Not if there's someone like TX3 Shelby throwing a move on you whenever you're not suspecting it.
Shelby hasn't looked good either today. Looked strong in the earlier races, but when we get here to the finals, and totally different vehicle here. 1982 Porsche 911 turbo 3.3, and it's a delicate, it's a white gloves kind of race. You know, any getting off to the side, even you saw Mellish hit that curb, that's going to cost you time, that's going to cost you spots.
Exactly, and we see it. You know, last time out we saw the Porsche 919, that LMP1 Le Mans winning beast. That kind of a car, you know, you can see it really shows when you're pushing it at its edge.
Yeah.
With a car like this, though, it's much harder to see with just your kind of naked eyes just how hard these guys are pushing, just because it's such a tetchy car, so tough to drive. And so even, you know, the fact they're running this kind of closer pack, putting together racing that's as compelling as it is to watch, is a real testament to how well these competitors are driving.
So that's how 5 through 12 looks. Let's hop up and see how 2-3-4 is looking right now, as Johnson's just way out front. Forget about him. He's already on the podium, unless something disastrous happens here. But, you know, this is a move that Eggie's going to have to make. He's been there most of the day. I think Kaiserwolf is the type of driver he can pass, especially if Anto and Kaiserwolf start to battle. Maybe Eggie's the guy that can close a little bit of this gap here in lap 8.
Lap 8 out of 14, just turning over to lap 9 now. So still with 5 circulations left of this track. You know, Eggie, he's got every chance in the world of making his way up to that battle for second position, seeing himself on the podium come the end of this race. It's a bigger ask for anybody from that bigger battle behind, the battle for 5th, to make their way up to this pack. They really have fallen a long way behind now. And you can see that on the track map on the bottom left there. Johnson just disappearing out of view. And that little second, third, fourth tussle now heading over the top of the track.
Yeah, you don't know a lot of technical racing terms. This is what they call a cluster F. This is what this pack is called.
Okay.
I'm trying to give you some new terminologies out there. Over in America, yeah. that's what we would call that pack.
Scott was telling me about straightaways earlier on today.
I'm like, they turn right? These cars turn right? Lap 9 is where we're at. Let's go all the way to the front. That's the guy. That's the story of the day. Johnson just absolutely dominating these last two races. And this is a guy that had the opportunity today to win all three. He had the lead for 7 of the 11 laps in race number 1. Won race number 2 in convincing fashion, and here in race 3, with just 4 laps to go, this is a guy that, let's be honest, he just loves the Porsche because he's looking strong.
Looking incredible, not just on that track.
Look at that. Come on now.
That's he's putting on a show. He knows he's on the camera now. Just hanging the back out there through turn 1. You know, a big shout out as well. I think it's a Skullsy Slash paint that he's repping right there.
Looks
it's
good.
Absolute beauty, isn't it?
Those are some familiar Porsche racing colors. And all the way back to 10th place, that's Pro Warrior. He's kind of at the back end. Oh, we got a little action going to the dirt there. And I didn't see who that was that fell off. Was that Shelby? I think that was Shelby that got a little squirrely.
Yeah.
And that'll put him to 10th.
Just losing out there. Yep. Hard to see an accident like that in the later stages of the race. Everyone wants to just bring it home at this point. Just make sure they're up there at the end. They've seen people coming off. Mellish making a mistake there. Warrior managing to punish him for that. Up to 8th position now for Warrior, who, you know, if he holds on to this kind of level of progression, he could see himself up into the top 5, I think, by the end of this race.
Slowly being patient, inching his way forward, taking a position or two. Really, his strategy here in this final race is he's going to let everyone else make the mistake. Right here in 4th place, that is Eggie again. You can see Kaiserwerf and Anzo just out in front here as we move into lap 11. He's got some, going to have to make up some space here. Yeah. See if he can do it through this first turn.
Anto and Kaiserwolf, though, going side by side there into turn 2. So these two starting to get really tangled with one another. This is exactly what Eggie wanted. Let's hop forward just to Kaiserwolf, yeah, though, so we've got a front row seat for this battle for second position.
See him there putting it down into second gear. And that's when you keep those high rev RPMs up, keep it in second. And you can see him over revving at times, just wanting to keep that second and third gear. That's the majority of what you're seeing when you're going through this part of the track.
It is. Look at that. Just hanging the back out there, Kaiserwolf. I wonder if this is one of the cars where the pro drivers will use a little bit of handbrake just to make sure the back pops out. And I wonder if that's what we saw from Kaiserwolf there, as he almost drifted through the hairpin.
Well, here we go. Anzo trying to close the door. Trying to keep Kaiserwolf off. Kaiserwolf has not raced well today, but he's looked good here in race number three. And boy, just thought he had the window open for a second. And I mean, he's giving no quarter to Anto here. He's really riding that same line. Both these guys on the same line. Very fast line here, Allie. Just waiting that maybe Anto will make a mistake.
Tucked into that draft of Anto's and just hoping to be able to pull a lunge off here. Anto's braked very, very late, though, and he's going to have to cut back for the second apex. Whew, close
stuff. What point does Kaiserwolf roll the dice here a bit? It's, you know, you're in lap 12 of 14. At some point, you know you need a high finish. Second place could be everything for Kaiserwolf.
He wants it. You can see he wants it. He's not going to let this drop until the end of this race. Lap 12 now of 14. Johnson's up the road in first. So the best he can do is second. But the worst he can do is a lot, lot worse than third. You know?
Well, he's starting to shorten up that line. He's starting to shorten up those corners a little bit as Anto is getting, you know, wider through that, those, you know, through the corners, playing a bit defensive, which is, you know, he's had a lot of success with. You saw him in race number one when he got past Johnson. He took that defensive line and really gave Johnson nothing, no chance to ever get back in the race as he took first place in race number one. And he's holding strong here in second place of race number three.
You know, something Kaiserwolf is going to want to watch is the second, the right-hander there on that chicane. I saw him last lap as well, just being maybe a little bit tight on it, just not quite four wheels on the track. And so at some point, he may want to start sort of just making sure that the marshals are aware that isn't his racing line, is that, and that's more of a sort of mistake that he's just now made a couple of times, rather than a consistent advantage that he's trying to gain by maybe cutting the track.
Yeah, I think he's just trying to keep that 911 turbo just in position, you know, because, I mean, you got to be careful when you're driving around here. You know, you're trying to make a move. You're trying to overtake. And sometimes you can be so focused on that car ahead of you that you lose a little bit of where you're at on your line.
Agreed, and that's completely natural. You know, I think it's all about this hard competition, this, you know, just driving your heart out when you're out there.
Uh-oh.
Just a slide there, I know. These two get so close through this section every lap now. Anto just backing Kaiserwolf up on the apex every single time. And I can't see where Kaiserwolf can do this. You know, where can he find the move?
He's going to have Anto make a mistake here as they're working their way through turn 11 and 12. And, of course, New Holland's coming up. Really, at some point, Kaiserwolf's got to try to decide if he's going to make a move. But Anto's giving him nothing.
Absolutely nothing. And that's, you know, credit to Anto here. As they start the final lap of this race, Johnson now 1,500 feet up the road.
Here he is.
I love that livery. I've said it already this race. I can't say it enough. It's awesome. I'm going to go and get it straight after this.
Yeah, final lap. There's your guys. Led wire to wire, just like he did in race two. And boy, he looked strong here in race number three of the finals. We're here in the Forza Racing Championship, season three, the Porsche Cup. And we're in week three of four. And don't forget, we got North American Racing coming up at 4 p.m. Eastern. That's 1 Pacific for those on the West Coast in America.
Kaiserwolf's last chance here on the final lap. Has he got anything through the last sector? I think Anto's got all his bases covered here. He's going to be able to get away with that second position, and he'll have to, Kaiserwolf will have to, you know, settle for a shake of the hands after this event. We can hop forward though to attacks Johnson in the lead of this race. Yep. As he tries to take the checkered flag.
Yeah, Johnson up front. There's the man. Has looked so good today, and provisionally, he will take his second checkered flag here on a Sunday.
Great job from Johnson there. And, you know, even now, it's Anto and Kaiserwolf passing the line all that time between them. Great drive, though, from Anto to hold off Kaiserwolf. He was a hungry puppy in third position there.
Yeah, able to Nice defensive line. Antos looked good today, too. I know he struggled a little bit in race three after taking the checker flag in race one. Mr. Jackal finished fifth. Diesel sixth. Lee Campbell will take seventh, and Warrior was right behind him in eighth. Utai in nine, Shelby in 10, Mellish in 11. And tell you what, race three in the books. But today, it's been all about Johnson.
It has. It's been Johnson's day in the sun, hasn't it? Brilliant stuff from him. Second place, first, and now provisionally at least, another win here.
Was that a poke at my sunburn here? I've been out in the sun.
He goes outside sometimes.
He's been dominant. And you know, Anto is the kind of guy that can push Johnson, as we saw in race number one, but he just hadn't had the chance. Didn't have the chance in race number two as he fell down to sixth. In this one, the battle between Kaiserwerf and Anto, neither of those guys able to catch up with Johnson. He's just out there running. He might as well be in practice mode. He might as well be out there by himself running hot laps.
You know, that's it. Johnson here has done a great job setting himself up for this event. You have to remember, you know, it's so important in this format to get yourself on the front row, get that pole position, and he's just made the most of it, converted twice out of his three chances. Brilliant performance, brilliant stuff.
Looked strong in the semis. I mean, that was one of the things. When we saw him run in the semis, just had a feeling that this might be his day.
Yeah, no, exactly. We saw him, you know, we were standing there and watching it happen, and, you know, he looked so strong from the start. At the same time, though, there are other people who look very strong as well. Paps, we never saw him today. Championship leader in EMEA.
Actually looking forward to seeing Paps. He just looked dominant in the first 2 weeks.
First 2 weeks, you know, he looked great. And then, you know, he'd come along today and looked strong in the semis as well, got a little bit of bad luck. And that's how it goes sometimes on the racetrack. You know, you have to be able to make hay while the sun shines.
Yeah, another sunburn joke. I feel it. It's a slow burn, but it gets to me. We are waiting on the provisional results. I think we got them. After that third race comes to the conclusion, we'll show you how those guys finished here in a moment. Did you see anything out there that you're like, the marshals are going to have to take a look at that one again?
You know, you have to put on sort of a different hat for each different car, right?
Right.
If they had been bumping like there was bumping in that race in the 919, for example, in Virginia.
Unacceptable.
Out, right? But here, it's a C-class car. It's a little bit slower. It's also very difficult to handle.
Yeah. You saw the handling characteristics of that 911. But you're going to have some bumping. You're going to have some absorbing. And when you're at those lower speeds, you're able to recover. You mentioned the 919. I mean, you know, you're in triple digits and someone gives you a nudge. Yeah, that's a little different.
It is, exactly. And so here, you know, we've seen a lot of grinding, we've seen a lot of bumping, but they're going to get away with it, basically. You know, there's going to be some, I'm sure there'll be some penalties, don't get me wrong, but I didn't see anything myself that looked malicious or bad.
Here's the provisional results for race number three. Johnson taking home his second straight checkered flag. Anto Kaiserwolf, Eggy, Mr. Jack representing TX3. Diesel holding in there strong. He's had a good day today. Lee Campbell in seventh. Warrior with his best finish of the day at eight. Utite has moved up to nine, one of his best performances. And then the disappointment for Shelby Mellish, who drops down to 11. And Vita. Come on, Vita.
Yeah.
I'm not your Vita.
poor old Vita. You know, what a tough day on the track for him. And you could see the frustration coming out in the penalties. The bumping, the frustration makes more frustration, and the whole thing goes wrong. You know, it's all about keeping a clear head, keeping calm. And I don't think Vita's been able to do that at the track today.
I think that's a good, really, word of advice to a lot of the drivers out there. He was the most aggressive driver of the day. And people are like, oh, man, you got to be aggressive, got to be aggressive. Well, that'll get you two 11th place finishes and one 12th unofficially.
Exactly. And you can feel like you're backing off so much in order to not bump into people ahead of you. You can feel really like you're holding back. But as long as you keep your nose clean, then that's rewarded by the marshals. It's rewarded by the race points later on. And it's the way to drive in competitions, you know, as big as the Forza Racing Championship.
That's a big part of what's changed here in Season 3. We're going to step away from a moment. When we come back, we're going to have your final official results after the adjudication of Race 3. We've had a great day so far. North America coming up a little later. Don't go anywhere. Final results coming up next.
I never really noticed scars. I've always just been there. The box that takes me to school, that we take family trips in. But one day, my dad took me to this place. The cars didn't look like boxes anymore. They were different. Some were older, some were newer, but they all came from the same place. They had wings and muscles and eyes that looked at you. They were all fast. The engines sounded angry. They made everyone happy. The cars weren't dirty, but people cleaned them anyway. Total strangers made new friends, and all the grown-ups stopped acting like grown-ups. I never really noticed cars before. Now I can't stop thinking about them.
Welcome back. Happy Sunday to you. We've had an incredible day of European racing. North America coming up 4 p.m. Eastern. That's 9 over here in London. So we'll be back and look forward to some of that North America racing. Race 3 is in the books. Johnson finished first. We're still kind of waiting for the results to get ironed out. But he has looked very strong today, Allie.
Yeah, no, brilliant performance from Johnson throughout the three races, just being denied that win.
There we go.
One time.
So Johnson will finish first, Anto second, Kaiserwerth three, Edgy, Diesel, Lee Campbell, Warrior, I don't know why I want to call him Edgy, and Mr. Jack got a 10-second penalty, Vito with a warning. They can just keep that up on the graphic with his name. They could change his name to Vito Warning. And then Shelby with a 5-second penalty will finish 12th. Any surprises out there for you?
Not particularly, no. There was a lot of bumping in that race. You know, I think the stewards have handed out penalties based on the more serious incidents, right. Certainly. Kaiser Wolf getting away with it there in third position. Certainly for me, I thought I saw a few moments when he was four wheels off the track there in the last sector of the lap. And I think Vida getting a warning for turn one.
Yeah, Mr. Jack was there in turn one where really caused a mess of lap one right off the bat. And that's what that led to that pretty much that log jam of really 5 through 12 was sort of logged up the whole time. We had second through fourth, but it's really been Johnson. Johnson's been the guy taking a look at the leaderboard here. He's been the guy from race one that has come in and just taken over big time. You see back-to-back wins. Could have won the first one before Anto overtook him in lap 7 of 11. Anto's looked good as well. He's in second place. Diesel, Eggy, Mr. Jack in fifth. Kaiser Wolf has come back to move up to sixth place after starting the day in 11. Campbell, your guy Mellish, looked good for the first two races. Did not go his way in race 3.
It didn't at all. You can see that there's a big points difference there between Mellish in eighth position and the four drivers that came after him, Warrior, Shelby, Utite, and Vida. All of those drivers failing to break into double digits, whereas the other guys, yeah, up there in the 20s, 30s, and even up to 60s.
Well, you can see Mellish, you know, if he had just a decent finish in race 3, would have probably finished in that number 6 spot right around Kaiser Wolf.
Yeah, he would have done. You know, it wouldn't have taken a huge amount different from him. You know, at the same time, that C-Class car was very difficult to handle. There was definitely a lot of dice rolling happening there. We saw this big, as you say, a log jam of cars, you know, just all of them.
Which was exciting.
It was exciting to watch, yeah.
So we've had a lot of the great community members out there watching today. Those guys always tuning in and showing patience with me, a newcomer. And we got some new faces out there watching. Why don't you tell the folks out there how they can get involved with the whole Forza Racing Championship?
Yeah, exactly. It's super easy to get involved with. Just head over to forzarc.gfinity.net. You can see the website address right there. And all you need to do is link up your Xbox Live gamertag to the website, the Gfinity website, and then you head off to the Porsche tab, the main menu of Forza Motorsport 6, and there you've got like a bunch of challenges to take part in. Forza Horizon 3 as well. Also recreational games on there. So loads of ways to get involved and all sorts of prizes to be won.
Yeah, still one more week to go. We're just in week 3 of 4. So if you're out there and you're like, I just found out about this thing, you still have time to come out and make your mark. You could be one of 100 drivers to join us at Le Mans in France on June 17 and 18. Well, we're done with Europe. North America is still to come about 4 hours from now, so get yourself a ham sandwich, get settled in, because we got some good North America racing coming up later on tonight. Any favorites for you for North America?
You know, last time out, we saw Car Harmonic bringing it for Esports and Cars alongside his teammate Raceboy. Can they come back for a second week and do the same? You know, that's the big question for me.
You know, Raceboy's look strong. You know, big-time streamer on Twitch. We didn't know kind of what he would do at the Invitational, but he kind of came in and looked very good in a live final scenario.
Yep.
If he can get himself to France, which pretty much we know he's going to be there, he could be a guy that can make a move for the North American crew.
For sure, for sure. It's all about nerves under pressure out there, and every bit of experience helps with that.
Well, we'll see you guys about 4 hours from now. Thank you so much for tuning in. We will see you guys tonight. For Ali, I'm Scott Cole, and the whole rest of the crew, come on. We'll see you tonight.
this for Richard.
I don't need to see him. Tell him it's from Thomas.
Richard? Someone called Thomas dropped this off for you.
Thomas? From the office?
Thomas drove 400 miles to drop off this.
438.
Whatever would possess him to do such a thing? He could have given it to me on Monday.